Analysis, Opinion, The Zinoviev Letter, The Conspiracy That Never Dies by Gil Bennett, Oxford University Press, $34.95, 340 pages for almost a century, a suspected forged letter advocating Russian meddling in a British election has bedeviled politicians of all denominations, especially the Labour Party. As an outsider taking my first intensive look at the evidence behind the Zinoviev letter, I can only conclude that the prolonged boo-hooing by leftists should have been tossed into the rubbish bin of history decades ago. Yet the supposed mystery of the letter shows no signs of abating. Now we have a book by Gil Bennett, Chief Historian of the British Foreign Office, 1995-2005, which offers what is a logical conclusion. The background: in 1924, the Labour Party ruled Britain for the first time. Times were tense. The Soviet Union, acting through the Communist International, the Comintern, was urging the violent overthrow of governments worldwide, and especially those in Britain and colonial India. Oblivious to the Red Threat, Labour pressed for the diplomatic recognition of the Russian government. Understandably, conservatives opposed such a move, insisting that any agreement include a Soviet promise not to try to influence British politics. Moscow refused any such pledge. The Communist Party of Great Britain, CPGB, happily allied itself with Moscow's call to revolution. To cite one episode, John Ross Campbell, a leading Scottish communist and assistant editor of the Workers' Weekly, published an article calling on the armed forces to join to form the nucleus of an organization that will prepare the whole of the soldiers, sailors and airmen, not merely to refuse to go to war but to go forward in a common attack upon the capitalists and smash capitalism forever. The government first moved to prosecute Campbell for exciting mutiny in the armed forces but backed down under leftist protests about freedom of speech. But other statements urging voter mobilization in favor of Labour continued, many under the signature of Grigory Zinoviev, the Comintern chairman who was a key figure in the government of Joseph Stalin. He would be shot during the 1930s terror. Then, on October 9, CIS received a decoded telegram from its station in Riga, the Latvian capital, an intelligence listening post. Addressed to the Central Committee of the CPGB and bearing the signature of Zinoviev, the 2.5-page letter was a plea for the re-election of Prime Minister J. Ramsay MacDonald in Labour. A key sentence read, "Armed warfare must be preceded by a struggle against the inclination to compromise, embedded among the majority of British workmen." It called for enlistment of the more talented military specialists. The letter was said to have come from an agent designated FR3K, part of a network that had previously produced letters from Zinoviev to communists worldwide. The agent's reports had proved valid in the past. Given the intelligence source, nothing official was said. MacDonald cautioned that any protests must be well-founded. After inquiries of CIS, a Foreign Office official accepted the authenticity of the letter and prepared a protest letter for MacDonald's signature. And here Ms. Bennett addresses what became the key issue of the controversy. Based on Foreign Office documents she examined, this is certification, made by Muj. Desmond Morton, was built on shaky ground. No evidence was found that he had talked with the claimed source of the letter. Nor could his claim be confirmed that a source in the CPGB confirmed receipt of the letter. Nonetheless, the language in the letter jibed with that in numerous other communiques from Zinoviev in CIS possession. Given the tight overlap of senior CIS officers and the London conservative establishment, word of an explosive red letter quickly circulated. The Daily Mail broke the story on October 25 under the headline, "Civil War Plot by Socialists Masters, Moscow Orders to a Reds." The accompanying article said the letter had been seen by MacDonald some weeks ago, implying that the government had protested only in response to the press disclosure. Predictably, Bolshevik officials denounced the letter as a fraud and a dirty trick. The CPGB denied receiving any such letter, denouncing it as a clumsy fabrication, plot or not, in voting on October 29, the Conservative Party gained 161 seats in Parliament, Labour lost 40. Ms. Bennett suggests that the furore over the earlier Campbell article could have done electoral damage equal to the Zinoviev document. That the letter was dubious seems obvious. The question remains, did the CIS create the forgery? Or was the letter planted on a willingly gullible agency? Forgery was a major industry in the Bolshevik era, with both enemies and supporters of the Reds exchanging vicious broadsides. Nonetheless, the author states, the bitter experience was a breeding ground for dissension and recrimination, which continues to this day. Joseph Gooden writes frequently on intelligence matters. The Washington Times welcomes your comments on Spot.im, our third-party provider. Please read our comment policy before commenting.